Hello, everyone. I'm Joel Baird, the General Manager of Missoula Community Access Television, inviting you to another edition of Missoula Live, which is going to involve pets, Buddy, and Carrie. But first, I have to tell you, Kim is not here. She's feeling under the weather, and she's a little busy, too. So I'm going to carry the show alone. There's a few MCAT things I wanted to tell you about. First off, MCAT's first Friday, March 1st, is going to involve a movie club. So MCAT has a movie club. It meets every month, and people get together. You don't have to be special to join movie club. You just have an interest in movies. And this first Friday, which will be March 1st, it's at 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. here at MCAT. Movie Club is going to be showing some of the movies they've made in the last few years. It includes Christian Ackerman's Wisconsin Project X and a look at his new one. I see Peter Jackson documentary, Behind the Scenes of Making Something. And it's a pretty enjoyable event. We'll have refreshments for you. And you can feel free to drop by MCAT, 500 North Higgins, northeast corner of Spruce and Higgins, between 5 p.m. and 8 p.m. on March 1st. So here's another thing. They got it back there on a JPEG, this poster, though it's hard to read back there. Okay, so there's the back there poster. This contest is held by MCAT every year. This is the third year of the contest. It's called Do It in 72. And in Do It in 72, you get 72 hours to make a movie. On Friday, April 15th or so, we'll let you know what elements you need to put in your movie. And the movie's due that Monday. The first prize is $500, second prize $300, and honorable mention $100. And there's a similar cash bounty. I know this is back there too. This is a poster for a high school film festival. It's the 12th year that we've done the high school film festival. The movies can be 4 minutes, 5 minutes is maximum. And the work has to be completed while you're a high school student, you know, in the last year or two. The entries are going to be due the same weekend as Do It in 72, which is actually April the 19th. And pretty soon you can learn more about both of those contests on our website, MCAT.org. Well, and the last thing I promised Ginny Miriam at the city, I would mention to you guys that the city of Missoula, University of Montana, Missoula County, are having another State of the Community event. This is Thursday, February the 21st at 7 p.m. at the Montana Theater, which is on the campus of the University of Montana. It's in the Performing Radio Art TV building. And the event is Thursday, February 21st, 7 p.m. It's free. Each one of these people, Mayor John Engen, the president of the University of Montana, Royce Engstrom, and a county commissioner, Gene Curtis, in this instance, second annual event. They'll discuss innovations, collaborations of the past year, talk about the work they're doing, hope to do in the future, and then you guys get to ask questions. Now, MCAT is recording that event of State of Missoula Community, so you can see it here if you can't get up there. So on to my first three guests. Right here in me lap is Buddy. And I see the lower third was chopping out Buddy's face. And with me is Lora O'Conner. Welcome.
Hi.
Laura's here from the Western Humane Society. Or no, it's called the Humane Society of Western Montana.
Yes.
And it's a spay day coming up, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Spay and neuter. Spay. That's why we've got one of each.
We have one of each. They're from the same litter.
Are you a girl?
And each year we participate in spay day, which is recognized across actually the world. And there's lots of events where you can spay and neuter your pet at a lower cost. It's low income. So if you, you know, if you can go to your veterinarian, we ask that you go to your veterinarian. But if you can't afford it, then give us a call and we can help you out. Spayed and neutered pets are healthier, they live longer, they're less likely to roam, and they help reduce the pet population.
Well, of course, because, you know, no one likes to see that an animal is abandoned. Mm-hmm. You know, an animal has nowhere to go. And a lot of it comes from, well, this just birth control, right?
Mm-hmm.
And people can get in touch with the Humane Society to find out more about it on the website. I think these guys have the website open, though I didn't double check with them, to show people at home. It's like my Humane Society of Western Montana.org.
Yeah, my HSWM.org.
Yeah. And so here you see the spay and neuter clinics that are coming up. And then, so is it a really reduced rate? Like, mm-hmm. I don't know how much it costs because I haven't done my cat. Well, I did my cats a long, long time ago, you know?
Yeah, we recommend $25 for a cat, spay or neuter, and $50 for a spay or neuter a dog. And if you can't afford that, we, you know, whatever you can afford, we'll work it out.
That's really great.
So we really want to help, you know, help you get your animals, animals spayed and neutered.
Yeah. And then for people out there, this event does repeat itself, but is a great opportunity to take the Humane Society up on it.
Mm-hmm. We do some smaller clinics for cats throughout the year, but this probably will be our only dog clinic.
Okay.
So this is the largest clinic we do. And we do a large one every year in February.
Right. And they really need to take advantage of that.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Laura, is there anything you want to add? I see you've got, like, for instance, Celebrate 98.
We're 50 this year.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes, we are. We were established in 1963.
Wow.
And we just want to thank the community. You know, we have a 98% adoption rate, and it's because
of... Oh, that's great.
It's because of the great work in the community, so...
And you guys are more, you know, it's been a couple of years since you moved into your new facility.
Mm-hmm.
But you did move into a new facility in recent years when you take it 50 years into account.
Yes, we call it our new facility, but we moved there in 2005, so...
8 years ago. Good Lord, the time goes by. All right, I guess you guys really want to go, but thank you so much for coming by.
Thank you.
To talk about Spay and Neuter Day. People, please take advantage of it. We've got lots of guests on Missoula Live today, so stay with us. We'll be back pretty soon. Hi, you guys. We're back with Susan Anderson from the Sustainable Business Council of the Missoula area, right?
Yes.
SBC, that's how I know
it.
Thanks so much for coming over. I'm sorry I forgot you were coming.
Those things happen.
What is this woman doing? So you've got some pretty big news this week. You've got a really interesting program coming up.
We have the Director of Corporate Citizenship from Microsoft coming to talk about their sustainability efforts. The whole event is called Capitalism 2.0. Sustainability is the big picture. It's the reboot for how we might want to do business in the future. The real interesting thing, Steve Lippman is the director from Microsoft, and he's going to be describing how they made a commitment last year to become carbon neutral by the end of 2013. So a year and a half.
That's ambitious.
And they're planning to be carbon neutral, and they are well on their way.
No kidding.
So it should be really exciting to hear some of
the things. I wonder how they're going to do that. You know, recently, Ginny Miriam and Chase Jones is the new, coordinator for the city in saving energy and reducing our carbon footprint. And their ambitions are a little... longer term, you know, they're talking 2025 or something.
Right. Microsoft is doing a combination of things. Energy efficiency, of course, comes first. And I understand they've already reduced their electricity by 30%, 50% in some of the facilities. They're using some renewable energy in the form of put 2,000 solar cells on one of their roofs, and doing things like reducing corporate travel, that sort of thing. I guess they saved 30,000 metric tons of carbon by reducing corporate travel.
Yeah.
And then they're going to use offsets and RECs, carbon offsets and renewable energy credits, to make up the difference, whatever they can't actually reduce out.
Oh, that's what RECs are?
Yeah.
Renewable energy
credits. Yeah.
Could you explain to people a little bit what that means?
Yeah, so a renewable energy credit is where a company that can't get rid of all of their, say, coal-based use or carbon-based energy use, chooses to fund another project somewhere else that uses renewable energy. So while they don't actually get the electrons into their own facility, they're guaranteeing a certain number of electrons get out on the grid, and somebody gets to use them, even though it doesn't, you can't tell an electron exactly where to go.
No, I suppose
so,
you can't.
You know, you can't always exactly have it unless if it's on your roof and you know it goes into your building, you can't tell exactly.
Yeah.
But they're basically funding other projects.
Oh, I see. So they're saying, like, I can't really reduce the impact that I'm making on the environment, but I will take some money and try to help someone who can reduce it.
Right.
Go ahead and do that.
Yeah, that's pretty much the idea. Basically, it is a way to get renewable energy renewable energy online, and to where they're actually funding those projects.
Yeah.
They do as much as they can to reduce their own usage, and then they fund to make certain that green energy is actually out there.
That's really great. And the programs the Sustainable Business Council is offering, this is Thursday and Friday, so it's coming up, people, the 21st or 22nd. And it looks like some of the stuff is at the university, or if not all of it, because there's abbreviations I don't understand. Academic lecture in BMGT.
There's actually two lectures, two student classes that aren't open to the public, and those are what you're talking about. And then there's actually going to be three events that the public can attend. The first one is at 4:30 on Thursday. It's on the second floor in the School of Business in what they call the Gianchetta Piazza.
When you come off
the elevator there, you'll see
I saw that as pizza, in fact. So they're showing the folks at home the website where there's more information about this.
Yes.
And it's sbcmissoula.org, if I recollect correctly.
It's sbcmontana.org, actually.
Big.
Right.
Okay. So you can Google SBC Montana or go to sbcmontana.org and then get this detail.
Right.
The business building is the brand new one to my mind, even though it's been there 12 years.
Right.
The other one has been there 8 years. Yeah, there's the website address for the Sustainable Business Council. But it's a very visible building because it can be seen on the western edge of the campus off
from
of Arthur looking east.
Mm-hmm.
And this is during the school hours, so people have to think about parking a little bit if they're going to drive there.
So
the bus goes there.
Yeah, the reception's at 4:30, but the actual free public lecture is at 6, and that's sustainable business. How do we scale it in time? Obviously, Microsoft is planning to do this in time,
and really
so it's a great example. So that's a free public lecture. The reception has a little bit of a charge for it, so we encourage folks to go out and register so we can have enough food there. And then Friday morning we have a Sustainability Meets Technology Forum, which will be Mr. Lippman and some other local technology experts talking about what we need to do to change up our technology, what tools we have, what kind of training people will need, those sorts of things. That's at 8 a.m. at the Loft, which is 119 West Main downtown.
Right. In the beautiful La Flesh building, the second story, above Missoula Dance, downtown Dance Collective. Well, I'm glad to hear that because I was just musing the other day, you know, how we seem to be at this wild intersection that just when people are realizing how much impact energy production and consumption is having on the environment globally, with the global warming in particular, it seems to be just about the time we've come up with more and more stuff. Like, we have to have this lighted sign that is some 5 feet across by 3 feet high. As we talk, we are surrounded by these lights.
Right.
And everyone is getting more and more handheld things that never turn off. That always, you know, this television, if it is turned off, it has a little red glow to it. And there's a tablet and a Nook and a Kindle and all of these things associated with technology. So it's an extraordinary challenge, you know, like fighting fire with fire, like using technology to prevent the damage that technology is causing.
Yeah, well, and it's interesting, especially when you talk about things that are run by electricity, there's a lot of things we can do with software and other technologies to help us manage electricity, but at the same time, it takes electricity to use those tools, grid tools and those sorts of things.
Yeah.
It'll be real interesting to see Mr. Littman's perspective on those
definitely.
Things.
Definitely. And so all of the scheduled events are free with the exception of the reception?
The reception has a small charge and the technology forum has a small charge. It's $15 for members and $25 for public. The lecture itself is free. The reason there's a charge is because we're actually providing food at both of those events.
Oh, so you need to offset that a little bit.
Right.
And then people could become members easily enough on the website.
Yes.
And could you tell people briefly that, like, the history? You know, maybe they've never heard of Sustainable Business Council Missoula area and would like to know a teeny bit about
Sustainable
it.
Sustainable Business Council is about 10 years old. We've been doing lectures in the community for that long. Somewhere about 5 years ago, we started a bi-local campaign and Garden City Local Fest. So we try and support local purchasing. That's one way generally to reduce your carbon footprint is to have more local production and purchasing. So that's one of our big pushes. It also helps your community in a number of ways in terms of how many dollars stay in the community, jobs, local taxes, those sorts of things. So we do a lot to promote that with campaigns and contests and promotion for our members, those sorts of things, as well as all of our lectures on how to become more sustainable.
Yeah, and then it seems like a fun crew, like the crew used to meet here and we record a lecture.
Right.
But it seemed like for people, particularly small business people, it was a really great networking opportunity for them. They met other people like-minded that were trying to employ the same sort of earth morally sound type business practices and learn more about how they could achieve that from people that have been working at it for several years and so on.
Around all of our lectures and events like the one that we're doing with Mr. Littman, we try and have at least an hour of socializing time, networking time. So you come to learn, you learn a little bit about how to become more sustainable and then you can spend a lot of time chatting with other members about how they do it and those sorts of things.
Yeah, I think that part's really instructional too.
Yep.
And then each year you do an award ceremony.
We do. We did one in October this year. We're actually probably going to combine it with Local Fest this next year. So we're going to push it out to where it's going to be about 15 months out probably instead of a year. But we do have sustainability awards that we've been awarding for 6 or 7 years now.
Something like that.
So,
That's great. Well, so anything you want to add before I move along?
We'd love to have folks join us for any of the events that they can make it for. The reception and the forum, you can go out to our website to register for so we know how many folks are coming. Be very helpful.
SBCMontana.org.
Yes.
All right. So thanks so much for coming by. Thanks for sticking with us. We still have a few more guests on this edition of Missoula Live. We'll be right back.
Can anyone tell me which three countries have been involved in some type of revolution over the last few months? Jenna.
That would be Egypt, Libya, and Yemen.
Very good.
They said heroin would be the best high I ever had.
Sweetheart?
Said heroin would be the best high I ever had. They lied. Find out the truth about heroin. Drugfreeworld.org.
Sarah?
Oh my gosh, he's so cute.
Been doing like I taught you. Love the new tattoo, Sarah.
Dude, that's Sarah.
Who's
Sarah? The girl in the pink shirt. That's the girl I was telling you about.
Theater 2 on your left. Hey, Sarah. What color underwear today?
Hey, Sarah. So when are you going to post something new?
Anything you post online, anyone can see. So think before you post.
You guys, we're back with Judy Wright. Judy Wright is the Director of Solutions for Families Programs for the Women Information Network. And it says here it's the fastest growing network in the world. Judy, welcome.
Thank you. I'm very excited to be here and grateful for the opportunity to tell people about the WIN.
Yeah.
It's a women's informational network, and we do a lot of great work in 152 different countries.
That is really something. Now, some of it, or the work you do, is about parenting education.
It is, and I happen to be the global director of Solutions for Families, and as part of that, I teach parenting anyway. I'm a parent educator and I'm an author of many parenting books, and I brought these three just to kind of show you something that I'm doing at Artichoke Press and also with the Global Woman Summit is raising smart and kind kids. Because as I've done research, what we've found is that there's a time for us to teach children empathy. And that little envelope of time is before they're 7 or 8 years old, and we model it. We teach them by showing them and talking and playing lots of fun games. You'll find tons of fun games in here. So I'll leave these here for you, and you can give them to someone who comes.
Excellent.
But
and this is from the 77 Ways to Parent series. I'll just show you guys some of the covers.
But
and then it has the artichoke heart, and you were going to explain a little bit about that, the artichoke.
Well, I appreciate you asking. That's actually always a conversational starter. But I use the artichoke as my logo because it often demonstrates how families are. They're kind of closed and bristly, and we don't want to let people in. We don't want other information in. And the only way you get families and artichokes to open is with warmth and with patience.
Oh, interesting. Steam analogy.
Yeah, steampunk, yeah. But as you open them, you peel the leaves off, the closer you get to the heart. And that's what we try to do with families. And we try to teach that to families all over the world about being kind and being respectful and responsible and helping them to be resilient. No matter where they are in the world.
Right. And there was one website you said, okay, it's not working right now, but another one, which is the AskAntiArtichoke.com one.
Yes, if they contact me through that's actually a parenting column. It's AskAndyArtichoke.com, and that's a parenting blog. And if they go there and contact me through that, then I can put them in touch with the Women's Information Network, and I'm sure they will want to be part of that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, can you tell people a little more about it, like the solutions for families and why the Women's Network is growing so fast?
Well, for one thing, we have global summits. Last year, we were in 152 countries, and we ask the women three questions. And the three questions are the same, no matter whether they're in Missoula, Montana, or they're in Moscow, Russia. And it's, as women, how can we acknowledge our similarities and respect our differences? And then, how can women's roles be strengthened for increased peace and development in communities, nations, and worlds? And how can women live in greater dignity and contribute to the well-being of other women and families in our community, nations, and world? Now, the interesting thing about that, this is shared in 152 countries. We hope to have 1,000 before 2015, 1,000 global summits.
Wow.
Is that all of this is compiled and scientifically, whatever one does with those things, and taken to the United Nations and saying, this is what the women of the world want.
Oh, great. That's
and
a great idea.
The women and the families, this is what we need to have peace.
Mm-hmm. Oh, are they pointing at something? Oh, it's your Ask Annie Artichoke. So people at home, you can see the website, Ask Annie Artichoke. And Judy, could you describe to them, this is like a parenting blog.
It is.
And is there a place to email you or
it is.
To
all
get in touch
that,
and learn
yep,
more?
All of that information is on there, how to contact me, how to, and if they contact me, I'll put them directly in touch with the Women's Information Network.
Okay.
So yeah, that is it exactly.
Great.
Thank you for showing that.
Yeah, thanks for putting that up, you guys. I didn't realize that they would have that. Well, Judy, anything you want to add?
Just how grateful I am for the men who are so willing to stand up and support the needs of women and children in our community. I am married to a very loving man and know how important those male role figures are in our community. So thank you, Joel, for all that you do.
Most welcome. Thanks for coming on the show.
All right. We will see you soon.
Yeah. We'll be right back, you guys. I think Kia Lizak is here. I don't know whether there's Kia from the Zootown Community Arts Center. So we'll be right back after a few messages. We'll see you soon.
Take a picture of yourself, and it could go around to every single guy in the school.
I want him to like me more. He kept asking for pictures of me. He kept saying, well, nobody will find out. You won't get in trouble for it.
When the pictures were getting taken, I never thought they would end up on the internet.
They were trying to charge me as a sex offender because I had sent the picture, and I had sent it to another friend.
Every person has experienced saying something or doing something where we thought, I really shouldn't have done that. Sometimes we can fix that. If it's something where we said something to a friend, we know we shouldn't have said it, we can go back, we can apologize. Sexting is different. Once it's sent, we can't take it back. We can't apologize. We can't take back the damage that's done once that picture of us is out there.
Thank you. looks bad to you, how do you think it looks to him? Please help put an end to the violence.
Hear that?
How could I not?
They can't be serious. This is their third party this week, and I have a test tomorrow.
Yeah, and they blocked me in again.
Let's party! Anything left in here?
I bet they're gonna leave their garbage out again. They do this every time when they have friends over.
It's important to be considerate of others who live close to you. You wouldn't want neighbors like these. Make sure to control your garbage, obey Chapel Hill noise ordinances, park only in your driveway or other designated areas, obey all alcohol laws, and remember, we're all living in this community together, so be a good neighbor.
Hi, you guys, we're back. Tammy Bodlovic is here from the Flagship Afterschool Programs, and we're here to talk about an important fundraising event for Flagship. Tammy, welcome, thanks so much for coming.
Hi, thanks so much for having me today.
You're most welcome. So it's Fiesta for Flagship. It has been the theme of your major fundraiser for a number of years. And it's coming up March 9th.
It is.
You want to tell people a little bit about it?
It is coming up so fast. This is our 12th year hosting Fiesta for Flagship, which is our largest community fundraising event of the year. This
right.
event raises about one-third of our community fundraising goal.
Yeah, so it's pretty important.
Which is very, very important. It's Saturday, March the 9th. It'll be held at the Doubletree. It's your traditional dinner with a live auction and a silent auction. And this year we're having some very exciting entertainment, a little demonstration by the parkour club from Hellgate.
That
is the flagship activity. You're going to come in and entertain everybody. We're going to have a great dinner.
Uh-huh.
We have some wonderful masters of ceremony for the evening, and Jill Valley and Sheila Callahan.
Oh, that's great.
Mm-hmm. And it's a great way to come in and learn more about our program.
Yep. We were just showing people while we were talking the website for the Flagship, and I think it's pretty easy, isn't it, the website? It's like flagship.org or something.
Flagshipprogram.org.
Oh, yeah, it has program in it.
Gotta get that .org, too.
People, can they buy tickets from the website?
They can, yep.
Yeah.
You can buy tickets online. You can look at our auction items, what's coming up. We'll have pictures here shortly of some of the bigger things coming up.
On the website, there'll be pictures.
Mm-hmm. You can donate online. You can watch our Facebook every day. We kind of feature a new auction item that's coming up on our Flagship Program Facebook page, and you can always call us for tickets. You can buy tickets at the door, but it's probably we were maxed out last year, so it's probably a good idea to buy them in advance.
Oh, that's good though. Mm-hmm. And in case people don't know, the Flagship Programs provide like a safe after school experience for what would you call it, say at-risk kids, but partly because of the latchkey society, you know, that a lot of parents, both of them, have to work till after five, school lets out after three, so there's that really tough period of kids don't have any parental supervision. Mm-hmm. And Flagship seeks to fill that gap, right, by offering all these groovy activities right after school.
Research does show that the most at-risk behavior occurs between 3 and 6 p.m. when your parents are at work. We consider all kids to be at risk for at-risk behavior, and so we do provide free to all after-school skill-building programs where you're learning activities and getting help with your homework and mentoring and doing community service and having access to things that otherwise you may not have due to means or just opportunity. And we operate in 8 schools here in Missoula County, and throughout the entire school year, we serve over 7,000 youth per year.
Yeah, and that's quite a bit of to doing. MCAT does a flagship activity at Washington School. We have for, I think, 2 or 3 years now. And kids learn how to make short videos.
Yep.
And sometimes they come here to the MCAT studios. Sometimes, and a lot of the times, they've been going to Washington School because it's easier, you know, transportation-wise.
Right. It's very easy to keep the kids on site.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
It's a big deal.
And it seems to be real popular, though.
Yes,
you know, the video
is.
Program seems to be pretty popular.
I've seen the videos. They're excellent.
Yeah, they're pretty funny,
the kids
aren't
enjoy
they?
It.
So, I mean, it's a very worthwhile program. And you guys are filling in that gap, you know, that the school system, it can't because they have just so much time in the day, too. But you use the school facilities, very often anyway.
Yes, we are Missoula County Public Schools official after school program. So we do have space. We have a worker housed in each school that coordinates all the programs.
Right.
And then we do utilize school space after school, non-school hours, during the summer, lunch, all that sort of stuff. And it is important. I think you'll find that a lot of programs you can lose, you know, when you have to rely on transportation, and if the parents aren't there to transport them,
yeah,
they can't get there.
Right.
So being on site, and if we do go off site anywhere, then we provide transportation.
Right, like when the kids come here,
right,
usually they go over and get them and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a very efficient use of the school grounds too, because they're already there. It's already heated and lighted and the rest
mm-hmm.
of that.
Familiar environment.
Yeah, for the kids. And mm-hmm. I think to a degree it's empowering for the kids to have an after school activity, because then they feel like the school is sort of their home. You know, like if you stay after work, you're kind of like, oh, I get it. I kind of live here. I don't mean in a pejorative way.
No.
But that the kids, you know, they feel like, well, this is my place. They're not just like some anonymous face coming into the classroom.
Right. And Flagship has been a part of studies where the activities have increased attachment to school, which is
yeah.
very important. And it increases attendance because kids want to go to school so they can do their after school activities, whether it's hip hop dance or
right.
just hanging out with their high school buddy if it's a little kid.
Yeah, there's a lot to be said for it anyway. Oh, so just to repeat, the fundraiser is the 12th annual one. It is March the 9th, which is a Saturday,
yep.
6 p.m. at the Doubletree Hotel. And tickets are $60, or you can get two for $110. And the best place to get it is at the website, right? I mean, or
yes.
easiest. Or
easiest
if they
place.
Wanted to call, they could just call.
They could call our fabulous administrative assistant, Jenny, and
yeah.
she will run your card and mail your tickets out to you anytime.
That's great. Well, Tammy, thanks so much for coming by.
All right,
tell
thank
people
you.
About it. And good luck with the fundraiser.
Thank you. Thank you.
You know it. And we'll be right back, you guys, right after this. I'll just finish the program and give you a little more information about our contest.
Get your show on MCAT. There's a few steps. Make your show. When you finish your show, all you have to do, fill out your program contract for absolutely no fee. What kind of deal is that? Also online. Remember, you must be a Missoula resident. If not, you can have your friend from Missoula turn it in for you as a sponsor. Turn in your show at MCAT. In 3 to 4 weeks, you can have your show on MCAT. And that's how you get your show on MCAT. For more information, contact MCAT, Missoula Community Access Television, at 542-6228 and at MCAT.org.
Well, that's our show for today, you guys. Thanks for watching this edition of Missoula Live. I just want to remind you that MCAT is part of the First Friday Gallery Walk program. And this coming Friday, March 1st, that's when it's going to be next, is going to feature the works of Movie Club here at MCAT from 5 to 8 p.m. MCAT's at 500 North Higgins Avenue, the northeast corner of Spruce and Higgins. And the movie club screenings are going to involve Christian Ackerman's Wisconsin Project X. He's got a short documentary on Peter Jackson, the director. And there are going to be some other shorts. And we will be providing a refreshment to you, so feel free to stop on down. And then another news item here at MCAT is the High School Film Festival, the 12th year that we've done it. High school students are invited to submit short films, 4 to 7 minutes or so, to MCAT The deadline is going to be on April 19th at 5 p.m. The prizes are $500, the top prize. Second prize is $300, and the honorable mention gets $100. Now, for adults and everybody, you don't have to be a high school student for this other contest. This contest is kind of interesting. You're invited to make a movie in 72 hours. You can do scripting and location scouting for your movie in advance, but we will give you a list of five items to include in your movie. You got to choose three of the five items. And we're only going to tell you that on Friday, April 19th at 5 p.m. And then your movie is due to MCAT on the following Monday at 5 p.m. And then similarly, we've got pretty good cash prizes there, $500, $300, and $100. Best prize in the third annual Do It in 72 MCAT Festival. Well, thanks for watching this edition of Missoula Live. I'm sorry, Kim, my co-host, couldn't be here today. She'll be here in 2 weeks. Missoula Live will come back to you on Monday, March 4th. Until then, I'm Joel Baird, General Manager of Missoula Community Access Television. Thanks for watching.